smell, sex, and candy hair. Who's out lounging in my chair? Who's out casting devious stares in my direction? Mama, this surely is a dream. Yeah. Yeah, mama, this surely is a dream. Yeah.
All right, welcome back to Political-ish. We're here with a reoccurring guest and maybe one of my favorite people in the world, John Cabrera, retired from the Sacramento Police Department. Now you are just doing retiree stuff. You're still in the investigation business?
No, I'm completely out of that, but I'm just doing a little bit of everything else.
But you've been involved, I swear to God, in just about every major case that has come through Sacramento. And that's saying a lot, because it's not like being involved in every major case that comes through Ames, Iowa. For whatever reason, Sacramento has been like the crossroads of serial killers, of spree killers. I mean, if you sit down and try to make a list, like that's a really long list. And you've been at the heart of a lot of these. And there are a couple of, more that I want to go over with you at some time in the future. But we've done a couple of really good ones. And it's kind of funny because every time you and I talk, you are like, dude, we got to talk about the Batgirl. And I'm like, what? I don't get it. Why are you so on the Batgirl? And you're like, no, like she was such a fascinating case. And I remember it because I was in Sacramento in the early 90s when Michelle Cummiskey, who was known as the Batgirl killer, when she committed a horrendous crime. And Sacramento was really paralyzed over that crime again because of the nature of the crime. It was a 58-year-old retired veteran, Air Force veteran, and it was a very attractive 20-year-old young woman, had bats tattooed around her arm at a time when not a lot of people had tattoos outside of sailors and construction workers. And she had vampire marks tattooed on her neck with blood dripping out of them. I remember it. It was a very, very sensational crime in the very early 90s, turn of the 80s in Sacramento. But I was like, dude, there's so many others. What about like this and that? You're like, no, we need to talk about Michelle Cummiskey, the Batgirl killer. And that's what we're going to do today. And I got to tell you this, John, it is really hard to find information on this now. And, you know, it was easy to find things on some of the other cases we've done. And it's easy to find information in YouTube videos on some cases that we will probably go over in the future. This one's tough. This one's tough. I don't know why, but why is that? What do you think?
Well, part of it is because the case never went to trial. When I arrested her back in Biloxi and we brought her back, she was booked, but we also held a grand jury inquiry, and grand jury found that there was enough evidence to indict her on the murder count. And so eventually after a year, she was going to take a plea deal because it was a death penalty case. It was a death penalty case. And so she decided she was going to take a plea deal, and they worked it out. And because of that, there wasn't any trial. And so a lot of the information that I had discovered that I thought that was just incredible was never put out to the public. They didn't have an opportunity to really see this person's life and what basically led up to this killing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was the information that was out there was short lived.
Yeah, it's kind of, it is funny because you always say it to me. You're like, dude, we got to talk about the Batgirl. Like, I really want to talk about that one. But from what I've read, I'm like, why? But that makes sense now. And now that we're here, you shared with me a lot of information, I think, that the public wasn't aware of. And you're right. It is incredibly interesting. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm a little conflicted on this case. Not conflicted legally. I'm conflicted in the sense that, and we're going to go over this, her background is one which is actually kind of sad. And it does not excuse what she did, but I wouldn't wish her background on anybody. I really wouldn't. It does not excuse what she did, but I do kind of feel for that person. But maybe I'm completely off base and you're going to tell me dude, you're crazy. She was a straight up psychopath, and she would have done this regardless of her background. And we'll find out about that.
Yeah, no, I mean, no, you're right. I mean, it is sad, but you can't use that to excuse her for what she had done. Of course, she had a background that, you know, didn't start really getting bad till about 14. I mean, it's something that you hear today. You have parents that have divorced, and the children live with either one or the other. And in this particular case, she lived with her father along with her brother. And so much was going on. She was 14. She was growing. And there probably was a lot of issues there that she really didn't have anybody to talk to. And so there was this frustration and this issue between her and her father. And I think it just grew and grew and grew to where it got to a point where she just decided she was going to take off. And at that time, she had taken off and gone over to live with her mother.
So, yeah. So what we're going to do now, and I think this is a good segue, let's walk through the background of Michelle Cummiskey, the Batgirl killer. And then after we walk through her background, let's touch briefly on Philip Inhofer, the victim. Yes. And then we're going to go over the crime. So she's 14, and let's set the stage, and we will have pictures for those who are watching this on YouTube. She was very attractive, athletic, 5'9". I think she was a blonde, light brown, naturally, because she dyed her hair a lot later, right?
Yeah, kind of a strawberry blonde type of hair, yeah.
She looked like an attractive volleyball player, right? Because she was tall, athletic, and attractive from the pictures. Though, it's interesting, if you look at the pictures, she does look like many different people in those pictures. She had a way of like changing her look a lot. So she's 14. She's in Iowa. She's in Iowa, right?
Liberty, Iowa.
And she runs away from home at 14. Where does she go? What road does she start taking?
Well, after she leaves her father's place, she goes to live with her mother for a brief period. But I think there was something going on there. We really couldn't put our finger on it, even though some of the people we talked to had talked about there was something between the stepfather and her. And she decided that she was going to take off. So she runs away. She completely takes off. And we believe from there, she went to Florida. She hitchhikes to Florida. And remember, you know, looking back, I'm thinking she has no money. So now she's trying to figure a way to work her way back to Florida or wherever she had gone at that particular time. So she was out there on the street. She was out trying to make contacts. And so even at that age, she was already trying to survive the streets. You know, where people her age normally would be like in junior high school or freshman year in high school, you would be thinking about going to a dance or going dating. Here she is out there trying to survive the streets.
So between the ages of 14 and 20, she lived in Reno, Phoenix, LA, Illinois, New York, Florida, Hawaii, and Sacramento, and Citrus Heights.
Right.
And that's in 6 years.
Yeah, and there's probably other places that we don't know of that she was.
But those are where you tracked her to, yes. Right? How did she survive? How did she make her money? How did she get along? What did you find out?
She found that it would be easy to make money her looks.
Between 14 and 19?
Her physical looks also. Dude, you know, she was 5'9", slender. She was well-built, you know, because she exercised a lot. And she had a great personality.
Were they military guys?
Smile, laugh, you know, all that kind of stuff. And she developed that well. And using that, she was able to make a lot of contacts with a lot of men.
She was married
and
twice.
And by doing that, she started to, of course, get involved in the flesh trade and got involved in prostitution, knowing that it was easy making money with men, you know, given her style and how she approached them and getting involved with them. She made a lot of money.
So you've dealt with a lot of, you know, in this case, women who have driven down that same road, who left home early, who have used their looks, et cetera, their personality to kind of, you know, manage and get by. How different was she than your run-of-the-mill person that goes down that lifestyle?
So what I find in some of my other cases where someone might have gone down that road, usually it ended in tragedy, or it ended where something, you know, completely changed their mind that they got out of that. In her particular case, what she did was, the longer she was out there, she honed her expertise.
She got better.
She got better at doing it. And the more she did, and the more she got a little bit better at everything, the more men she was bringing in. And she's found that this was just easy pickings. In fact, she had gotten to a point where she felt that her target men would be people that lived around military bases. For some reason, she had probably dated a few military people or found that they were easy to bring in and attract. And so she talked about, I liked being around military bases because I get a lot of men. I can get, bring, you know, guys that are home, you know, away from home, guys that are lonely, guys that have money, don't know where to spend it because they don't do anything. And there she was. And she was a recipient of a lot of that.
Yeah, they've got a steady paycheck.
Absolutely.
And so she lived in an apartment. As we go more now towards 1991, which was when the murder happened, at that time she was living in Citrus. She had an apartment in Citrus Heights on San Tomas Drive. You know, I was actually at McClellan Air Force Base at the time that the murder occurred in 91. I was there. And it's interesting because I remember the victim. I don't remember his face, but I worked in a clinic. I worked at the clinic, so all the retirees would come in, right? And all the active duty guys would come in and women. And I would have to go out there. I would work triage a lot, and I would go out there and I would call a name and I would say, like, you know, John Cabrera, and you would walk up and I'd go take your blood pressure and your pulse and say, what, you know, how are you feeling? What's going on? So I was a triage guy a lot. But I remember calling Philip Inhofer at least three times. You know, he's a retiree. We'd see him all day, right? So it was kind of interesting when this happened. I was like, oh, I remember that guy. So not to get on to Philip, but anyway, so I could see, you know, I could see the type that she was going after, right? I don't know what Philip did after he left the clinic with me, but he probably didn't have a lot going on, right? And I think if he got this young woman, this 20-year-old young woman looking like she did at that time, I think that probably, you know, rocked his world.
Oh, yeah. I mean, she was doing escort business at the time out of her place in Citrus Heights. So not only was she working up in Reno at Mustang Ranch, but she was doing escort services down here in the Sacramento area, Rockland, all the different areas she was visiting. I mean, at that time, there was the, she liked Rockland and Roseville area, you know, and people used to talk, oh, the 49ers were practicing out at Sierra College.
Right.
And one of her hangouts was, there was a club there, Bunce's. Bunce, one of
By
the
Dan Bunce.
Dan Bunce had a club there. That was a hangout she would go to. So she knew exactly where to go and, you know, how to present herself around these people.
You know who she reminds me of? She reminds me of a killer that you and I did before that we can't talk about for other reasons, who was here in Sacramento and ran a boarding house. But she was a very bad seed. But as she was in the lifestyle, she got better. And I see the same thing here. You're right. A lot of people, as they're when they're in this criminal lifestyle, it starts becoming too much and they start getting sloppy and it starts falling apart. They make mistakes.
Right.
But she seems to be the Batgirl seems to be one of those that, oh, this is my shit.
Oh, yeah.
I got this.
Yeah. She was honing her skills and she just got better at it. You know, to a point where she could actually decide what men she wanted, what men she turned away. And I can tell you from what I found, there were hundreds of men that she was around. And it was just incredible. When I found her ledger, when I found out
so she had a ledger.
Things, so she kept a ledger.
Like what would be in the ledger?
Well, in the ledger, she had people's names, phone numbers. She'd have a comment, the amount of money that she received from them. You know, and she always prided herself as being a businesswoman. And that's what her girlfriends would say.
She was 20. She was 20.
Well, she was 19. She was 19 when she killed Philip Inhofer.
Oh.
And
20 when she was sentenced.
Yes.
Okay.
And so, yeah, she had it going on. And so she felt that, you know, how she was running this whole situation, you know, but she kept a ledger. You know, she kept a lot of business cards because I saw a lot of business cards. She kept everything with her. And fortunately, I was able to get all that information at one point in the investigation. And that's what, you know, it made me realize how far her tentacles had extended across the United States and across these cities. and across military bases.
And this is the day before texting, before cell phones, right? She would have to either use her home phone or go to a phone booth. I mean, it wasn't easy. It's not like it was today, right?
I mean, no texting, nothing like that. It was phone calls, you know.
A letter.
Letters, a lot of letters, phone calls, things like that. I mean, the technology that you're seeing today, that wasn't there.
Yeah. Wow. That's wild. It was 19. And I apologize because I was thinking of the sentencing. But yeah, so when she did the murder, she was 19 years old. But I mean, this unbelievable lifestyle of this business up to the age of 19, that is crazy.
Yeah, she probably saw more than anyone her age would ever see in an entire lifetime. I mean, she just went everywhere and was with a lot of people. And, you know, and she was basically just giving up her body for money. And the money allowed her to survive the streets and to have the things that she wanted. And as she got better at it, she wanted more and more. And that's when, you know, of course, she meets Philip, and there's just something that she wants from him.
So before we get into Philip, so she's known as the Batgirl, and the media dubbed her the Batgirl because she had bats tattooed around her upper arm, right?
Yeah, she had bat tattoos. She had the vampire bite marks on her neck.
Again, in a day before people had tattoos, really.
Yes, yeah, she rare. Had. She loved Batman stories. She had a Batman key fob. She had artwork of Batgirl, but everything bats. And she was just really crazy about them. I mean, everything she had bats in it. But that, of course, went along with something else. And that was, she was a Satanist, she tells everyone, that she was a Satanist also. But she liked things like Dungeons and Dragons. She liked doing stained glass windows and things. And she liked bats.
So let's talk about the Satanism for a minute, because I know in a lot of the stories, and we'll get into this when we get into the actual crime, where Satan plays a role in that crime that she does. But how realistic was the whole, she was a Satanist? Do you believe in that? Or do you believe that she was? Do you think it was an excuse? I mean, what do you think?
Yeah, you know, at the time, you know, she admits that she is and that Satan had told her to do a lot of this stuff. But there wasn't really any real proof. I couldn't find that where she was part of an organization or that... you know, she had done things that would really make me believe that she was definitely into it. I think that was part of maybe a facade, you know, that she used, that she wasn't doing these things on her own, but that Satan was telling her to do them. And of course, she did say that to me.
Yeah.
She told me, hey, you know, Satan told me to do it. So, I think it's a little bit of both. As far as she was concerned.
So for people that don't know, at that time, again, we're talking before texting, before social media. So prostitution was very different then, right? I think it was run out of like the backs of newspapers, or I'm not sure. I mean, what were the usual mediums? But I want to get into the Mustang Ranch.
Well, you know, unfortunately, I had spent a year as a vice detective. And because of that, I had great knowledge of how prostitutes work, how their lifestyle, what they do, their johns, everybody. I saw how the system of prostitution worked. And so that really helped me in this investigation with her. But at the time, you know, word of mouth, escort services that you would find in the back of magazines or newspapers, you know, escort this, escort that. But a lot of it was by word of mouth, you know. You'd have one person in escort and then invite another person in, and that's what happened in her case.
Okay. And then, so she decided to up that game, though.
Yes.
And she went to the place that we all knew at that time was the Taj Mahal of prostitution, and that was the Mustang Ranch out in Nevada, where it was legal.
Yeah.
So it was run by a reputed mobster. I don't know if it's true or not. You probably know Joe Conforti.
Joe Conforti.
And he was the man. He ran the Mustang Ranch. People of that ilk went from near and far to the Mustang Ranch to seek out legal prostitution.
Right.
And under the guise, or under the watchful eyes of Joe Conforti, the reputed mobster. What happened to her at the Mustang Ranch? How did that go?
Well, at Mustang Ranch, she, from what we had learned, that she didn't really get along with a lot of the other girls. She excelled. She started to excel. She started to get more people. In fact, people coming in were asking for her. And I think it kind of, you know, kind of upset the other girls.
Because she's 19.
She was 18, 19. And she was bringing in a lot of people, and they wanted to come and see her. I mean, the astonishing thing is that during my investigation, I found a lot of business cards, and a lot of people were contacted in places like San Francisco and places south. And they had all been to Mustang Ranch, and that's where they met her. It was just, it was amazing.
And she kept those, like, she it's like marketing, right? She would keep their names, follow up.
Right. Yeah, she could call, make phone calls, and she kept this ledger. And had everybody's name in it. And then she'd put comments that I won't talk about, but she'd put comments about each, you know, get together with them. But, you know, I thought, wow, she went that far. Most prostitutes that I had learned, hey, you see a John, you get your money, bye-bye. But not with her. She, like I said, she considered herself a businesswoman. And this was just part of it, you know, how she was doing it. And she was getting good at it. And I think at Mustang Ranch, the other girls were not really happy with her because she was making a lot of money.
And she rose up fast. You have this amazing picture, and we're going to have the picture on the YouTube version of her sitting in a booth. And in the middle, you have the mobster Joe Conforte. See, this is something I never knew. I don't think anybody knew this stuff. Yeah. You have the mobster Joe Conforte, owner of the Mustang Ranch. And on his right-hand side is the Batgirl.
Yeah.
She's right there.
When we were up there, we were told by her former roommates that Michelle was his number one girl. And I thought, wow, that says a lot when you're, because number one, she was making money. And of course, when she made money, the ranch made money. So she was the number one girl. So yeah, when he was out on the town, which I don't think was that much, she was on his arm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, we were fortunate to find that photograph that was given to us. Who someone that had it, it was given to us on the photograph of her, one of the other girls. And in fact, it was the number two girl who after Michelle, we found out moved up to number one. So that's how it kind of worked. You know. So
doggy dog.
Yeah, that's what it was. I mean, that's how it is in that business. And of course, through the other people working at Mustang, the other girls, I mean, there is no honor among them. They told us everything. They kept nothing back. And so whatever she was doing, whatever she would say, we learned about it very quickly. So, yeah, there was some angst there among the other girls because she was the draw.
She had some sharp elbows.
I'll tell you so.
So at the Mustang Ranch, she meets Air Force retiree Philip Inhofer.
Yes.
What do we know about Philip, the victim?
What I had found out that, I mean, he was a great guy. He was a former veteran in the Air Force. He was a master sergeant. Wonderful person. People spoke of him so kindly and so good. He was a wonderful father. He was a wonderful grandfather. And, you know, what had happened is that he had become lonely. You know, he lived by himself. And after retirement, He was out working at McClellan Air Force Base, and he became lonely and he wanted company. And some of the people that he was around and some of the people that he dated, the older women, they were okay. They were good friends, but I think he was looking for something more than that. And so, you know, there became an opportunity where that he had met Michelle on one occasion. And on that occasion, there was a friend of hers that introduced them. And upon being introduced, I was told by the other person that Mr. Inhofer just fell head over heels.
Michelle must have had something, man.
Yeah, I mean, he was just fixated on her. And so the other gal moved out of the picture, and in comes Michelle. And she starts seeing Phil.
So before March 5th. Before March 5th of 1991, how long was that? How long did she know Phil before then?
We estimate about maybe 3-4 months.
Okay. So that's it.
That's it. That's all.
That's all it took. And she lived in Citrus Heights at the time. So she was probably going back and forth to the Mustang.
Right.
And then running her own game out here, right? With this amazing marketing network that she created.
Right.
Hundreds of men.
Hundreds.
Were there any cards or names that you ran across that you were like, oh boy?
Well, I can't speak to that. There was some cards that I thought, yeah, I could. Like I found like right over here at the Capitol, lobbyists. And so we made phone calls because, you know, of course I wanted to know, well, what was the connection here? And, you know, these phone calls were very strange.
I'm sure they were very uncomfortable.
And once I identified myself, you know, right. I'm Detective Cabrera, I'm investigating a homicide. Do you know a female by the name of Jade?
That's very, very important. She went by the name of Jade.
Jade.
That was her work name.
Jade was her work name.
Okay, very good.
And so we'd make these phone calls. And of course, everybody was like, you know, they'd have like all of a sudden amnesia took over. And it was like, well, and then I said, do you know a name, Michelle? No. But when I mentioned the name, how about Jade? And they was like, oh, yeah, that was a friend of mine I met. We had drinks, you know, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And I could just tell it was a very uncomfortable situation. And of course, I just said, look, I'm just trying to find out if you were a victim of any crime or theft. And then, of course, they seemed to settle down and like, oh, no. That was all. It was just someone to talk to when I was in Sacramento or, you know.
But tell her I love her.
Yeah. Yeah. And I got a lot of those.
Did you?
Love letters.
Really?
Love letters. Yeah. I found love letters from people. And it was just, don't forget me and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, it was amazing. It was really amazing.
But you run across lobbyists. That was awesome.
I remember. Yeah. I remember.
No legislators, though?
No, I couldn't. Yeah, I couldn't speak to that.
Okay.
I can't speak to that.
So. Wow, man. Well, that kind of made my show right there. I love that. So Philip Inhofer, and I think I shared with you guys earlier, you know, how I remember reading his name. Unfortunately, I called so many people in there, I don't remember his face. And but when the crime happened, I remember, oh my God, like I've met that guy. So he lived out in Natomas, right?
Yes.
In a trailer park called, I think, Stadium Club Estate?
Stadium Club, yeah. It was a mobile home park. Mm-hmm. And basically, it was filled with retirees, elderly people, because out there then, it was out sitting out there by themselves. I mean, it was way out there.
I was actually, that was the next thing I was going to talk about, because at that point in time, for those in Sacramento, Natomas in 1991 wasn't the Natomas you picture now. It was Fields. And you had some of those great pioneers of development, mobile home parks, and there were, you know, scattered throughout there. You had some modest homes for like people that worked in the fields, I think in like, you know, some of the areas, but pretty much it, you know, it was like garden land and, you know, there was just fields. It was dark. I remember Natomas as being dark. It was very dark.
Very.
Right?
Right.
So it's kind of the perfect place. You know what? So I don't tell people, I don't think I've ever shared this with anybody, but when I was in the military around that age, maybe a little earlier in the late 80s, I had run across this young woman in the clinic. She had come in and she seemed very interested in me, right? Her and her mother. She was with her mother. And I thought that was a little interesting, but she was like, you know, hey, you know, blah, blah, blah. And believe me, I was nothing to look at. So like, I was like, why is this like very attractive person so interested in me? And then I think we went on a date and went, and she lived with her mother in an apartment off of Arden and Fulton. And it was really weird because the father lived in a room, but the father didn't interact with them. Mm. And then so I was like, okay, this is kind of weird. And then the mother and daughter said, hey, let's all go out to have something to eat at a different time. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay, cool. That sounds all right. And they had me drive. And we drove to a trailer out in Natomas. We went to a mobile home park and they said, oh, we're going to be right back. And they went into a mobile home park and they went into a trailer and they're in there for about 20 minutes. And like, oh, no, we just need to see a friend. We need to see a friend. And they went in there and it was like, I think they were talking about how old he was. And then they came back like 20 minutes later and they're like, okay, let's go. And I was like, this is so weird.
Yeah.
But when this story happened, because this was like about 5 years before that, and I quit returning or, you know, talking to her again before cell phones. So like it wasn't hard to quit talking to people then. And then they never came back to the clinic where I worked. Right. But it was a very weird relationship between her and the mother. And when this crime happened, I always wondered, Oh my God, how many people were running scams on old veterans? Because I guarantee you they were running the same type of scam on some poor old guy in a trailer park out there in Natomas.
Right.
So that's all I could think about when this happened.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I mean, and then this particular trailer or a mobile home park, it was nice for that time. It was really nice, double wides. It was really nice neighborhood. But it's set way out there. I mean, you could go on Highway 70 or even I-5 as it started up, and there was nothing but fields. But then you looked out west from Highway I-5 and you could see lights out there. And that was the mobile home park. And so you couldn't miss it, but it was out there by itself.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there was nothing out there with
it. Because it's on the other side of I-5.
Yes.
Not the, like, where the old Arco Arena was. It was on the other side. There was nothing there.
No, but you could see the lights out there. Mm-hmm. But I'll tell you, it was as dark as a...
Yeah, that's... It's so funny you say
unbelievable.
That is my memory, is dark. So he lived on Gardendale. Was that it?
He lived on Gardendale, which was off El Centro. And then Gardendale is located within the mobile home park.
Yeah.
And that's where he lived. He lived in a nice double wide. It was a nice place.
And he had a car.
Yes.
You want to describe that car?
Yes.
The car's important.
Yeah, car's important in this. He owned a 75 450 SL Mercedes-Benz, red in color. And it was a cute little car. Hard top, you know, something that he really prided himself in having, and he loved that car.
And Michelle, in those 3 months that she got to know Mr. Inhofer, she saw the car.
Oh yeah.
And that's
caught her eye.
That's when this, you know, erstwhile businesswoman said, oh, I need this car in my life.
Yeah, right? The wheels started turning. So she talked about the car, but first of all, before the car, he started buying her a lot of stuff. I mean, I think her first thing to do with him was try to fleece him for as much money as she could, figure out what she could get out of him. I mean, here she is. She's 19. He's 58. And so for him, this is really nice to have this kind of young company. And like I said, she's a very attractive woman.
She was. You know, I mean,
and she had
pictures.
A great personality. She was a very extrovert. She could talk up a storm.
She must have been smart. I mean, she may not have been educated, but she must have been very smart to be able to put this together.
Yeah. She wasn't stupid. She's very smart. And I could tell that along the way. And even the way that she evaded law enforcement, you could tell she did her homework. And she knew exactly what she was doing and where she was going. So no, she wasn't ignorant where she got caught. Everything was thought about. And she was very bright.
So the wheels started turning. So how did she put this into play in what leads up to that night on March 5th?
Well, what happens is she's seeing him when she comes down and they're together, you know, but increasingly she starts asking him about his car and then finally gets to the point where she says, hey, you know, I want that car.
She told him that.
Yeah, I want the car. And of course, he just thought, oh, come on, that's my car. I can't give you that car. And she says, but I want that car.
I love
car.
You, but.
Yeah, I want that car. And he's like, nah, I can't do that. But at one point, I know that he probably thought about it because he didn't know the value of the car. But he had asked his son, who told us that one day, he just said, hey, what do you think the value of my Mercedes is? And his son said, well, I don't know. Why do you ask? And he goes, I was just wondering. And so that was unusual for him to ask his son. And, you know, so I know at that time, given what she was asking him, this is what he was thinking about more than likely, is that why does she want my car? Because of the value? Is it worth more than I think it's worth? But she wanted that car, but his position was, I can't do that. I can't give you that car, you know?
But she was, so she figured out she'd have to take it in a different way.
She had set in play that one way or the other, she was going to get this Mercedes.
Really?
Yeah.
God damn.
And she'd even shared that with friends, her girlfriends.
So there was a girlfriend on the day of March 5th.
Yes.
That they were with, right?
Yes.
And I'll get that to that in a second. One question I have for you is, so she has this very successful side gig. You know, she has the Mustang Ranch. She's the number one girl at the Mustang Ranch. She's the arm candy of the mobster, Joe Conforte. At the age of 19, she has an apartment, right, in Citrus Heights on San Tomas. And then, So I'm assuming she's making money. She's got cards of lobbyists, right? Of businessmen, the retirees. She's got a plan, right? Military bases, steady income. They can keep paying me. They got pensions, right?
Lots of military guys, too.
Yeah, lots of military
guys. And in fact, just like, I don't believe this. And every day in the morning, they'd go, Detective Cabrera, someone's here to talk to you. And I'm like, what yeah. is this? And it was somebody coming in. Yeah, can we talk? And, you know, hey, you know, I saw her. And, well, what had happened? Was there a crime committed? Or no, we just partied and had a great time. I mean, I even had a, I think this really, this day, it, I had pilots from Mather Air Force Base, several of them, come in one day. It was a flight wing, basically.
Jesus
Christ. They came in and I was like, yeah, okay. What can I do for you, gentlemen? Well, we partied with her on a Halloween party, you know, and here we go again. You know, we partied. Okay, well, what was anything? Did you lose anything? Was anything taken? Any crime? No, but, you know, we wanted to tell you that we partied with her.
So here's the question I've always had. She's incredibly successful in the endeavor that she has chosen yes. to pursue. She's in Nevada, you know, she's like growing. Where's the money? Because I know those apartments in Citrus Heights, they ain't all that. She obviously doesn't have a great car because she's got her eyes on poor Phil's. So where's the money going? Did she have a drug issue? I mean, what was happening?
Yeah, exactly. As much money as she was bringing in, she was using a lot of it for drugs.
Okay.
They always said the girls around her told us that LSD was her favorite, but of probably cocaine and a lot of the other drugs. So yeah, she was bringing in a lot of cash. She was making a lot of money. She even bought a car. It was a Dodge Daytona. She got into a wreck one evening as she was coming down to see Phil and abandoned the vehicle up on top of Donner Summit. Just left it and left everything in it and walked away. And she was picked up by some people, which would be a key part in my investigation. Some people picked her up and they were staying over there in the nearby area. So they drove over to the house where they were staying and they brought her with her and they said, hey, how can we help you? Because she's stranded up and it's snowing. So, you know, but that was another facet that I found, you know, while investigating this case. But she left her Dodge Daytona sitting at the top of Donner Summit and just left it.
So she was just burning through money.
Oh, yeah.
Drugs, LSD, cocaine, probably whatever else. Wrecking cars, leaving them by the side.
Yeah. For all the money she was making. And she prided herself with all the money she was making. And, you know, she would always tell her girlfriends, I'm going to someday go to Miami. And, you know, that's where I'm going to end up. I'll take all my money and I'm going to Miami. And that would become a clue for me, too.
Okay.
All those things would all become a clue. And I would use and keep thinking about that. What she talked about kind of created a roadmap for me on how to find her.
Well, let's get to March 5th then. Let's get to the crime. March 5th, how does that unroll? I know that she and her girlfriend had met with Phil. I think they went shopping. Why don't you walk me through what happened?
Well, on March 5th, one of the girls up there at Mustang Ranch, her close friend, drives her down to Sacramento because she doesn't have a car anymore. It got impounded by the CHP in Truckee, and so she doesn't have a car anymore. So her girlfriend drives her down to Sacramento to Phil's house. Now, she's already told the people at Mustang Ranch, I'm not coming back. I'm leaving. I'm going to Miami. And I'm going down to pick up my Mercedes-Benz. She told her girlfriends that.
I'm going to pick up my Mercedes-Benz.
I'm going to pick up my Mercedes-Benz. And of course, they were like, yeah, right. Okay. And so she got a girlfriend to drive her down. On the way down, they stop somewhere around Roseville. And they go to a Target. And her girlfriend, who I finally had spoke to, told me that they were in there and Jade or Michelle started asking one of the clerks about decon. If you put it in people's food, would it have some effect or could it kill them? And I think the gentleman that she spoke to was kind of like, well, I think if you gave them the poison, it would do something to them. But we were told by our girlfriend, yeah, this is what she was making an inquiry about, you know, decon. And because the idea was she was going to put decon and Phil in offers food, start feeding him poison.
And this was on her way to see Phil.
On her way to see Phil. So they get back on the road and they end up getting it all the way to Phil's house. And so her girlfriend stays for a little bit, unloads the things that belong to Michelle. Michelle tells her, okay, take care. You know, I'll see you. And in the meantime, while they're there, the girlfriend goes in and takes some of Phil's property.
That's right.
She takes some. She takes, while they're talking, Michelle is talking with him outside, you know, her girlfriend goes into the bedroom and takes some jewelry. And so then the girlfriend leaves and heads back to Nevada. And then that's when Michelle, now it's just Phil and Michelle for the evening, March 5th. But earlier that day, they had gone out shopping and we had found slips and we found out that he had taken her shopping and bought her clothes and bought her a lot of stuff on March 5th. And then after all of that, they came back to the house and prepared just for the evening. And that's when all of this would take place.
So what do you, what does the record, because I mean, I don't, did Michelle ever tell you what happened? I'm assuming she didn't. She doesn't seem like the type.
She told me what happened. She excluded a few key words, like, you know, when I asked, did you stab Phil? She said, no, I hurt him.
So what can you tell us happened that night that you found out from her and from the record?
Well, we found out that they were there together. He and her were preparing to go to bed, and he was going to take a shower. And so he goes and gets into the shower. He's in there taking a shower when all of a sudden she comes in and without any notice, she lunges at him with a knife while he's in the shower behind a curtain. And she starts stabbing him over, over and over again. It appears that he now pushes the curtain back, which is now in pieces and bleeding. He gets out of the tub in which the shower was located.
Probably falls, right?
Well, I don't know if he fell, but he doesn't have his glasses on, but he starts probably walking toward her with his hands out, trying to stop this flailing knife.
And she's just stabbing him.
She keeps stabbing him. She keeps stabbing him, and there's blood all over the place. They go out of the bathroom, go into the family room. There, they're probably fighting more. He's trying to basically just defend himself. He's got cuts all over his hands. I mean, there's blood everywhere.
You saw the scene?
Yes.
Okay.
And then he goes down. He goes down. But that wasn't enough.
How many stab wounds did the coroner say he had?
We figure over 30.
Over 30. And the knife was, what type of knife?
There were, in fact, two knives.
Oh.
We found, and I observed that on his body, in a position around his neck, there was a knife blade sticking out. So one knife went in and it broke off.
And she had another knife.
And then she got another knife and continued on.
This is 19-year-old.
19 years old.
Okay. So he's now down, right? And But that's not enough.
No, that's not enough. What she did is we believe is she has an aluminum baseball bat and she just starts taking it to his head to make sure that he's going to be gone. And one of the things that was so strange about that is that a neighbor tells us that somewhere close to midnight, he sees Phil's lights on. And he keeps hearing a thumping noise. So he thinks, you know, that Phil is either lifting weights and, you know, and he's dropping the weights on the mobile home floor and it's making that thump.
It was that loud.
That loud. And he's in the trailer across the roadway and he can hear this thump, thump, thump. And he thinks, well, Phil is doing something. So he's looking out where the sound's coming from. He sees the light on in Phil's bedroom. And then all of a sudden the light goes out and the thumping noise stops. He doesn't think anything of it other than Phil is probably working out, dropping weights or something. But when I look at the crime scene and when I find out finally what has taken place, I can see where the thumping noise was more than likely her taking that aluminum baseball bat to his skull. And it was making that loud a noise that it could be heard from a neighbor across the roadway.
And, you know, and as we have discussed earlier, she was no little girl.
No.
5'9", athletic. Like, she worked out a lot.
Like, she could definitely give you, if
she could swing,
you were
going
to fight her, she could definitely take care of herself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That loud. Yeah, I did read that in the record. I read that neighbors had heard a loud thumping. I didn't know that it was her aluminum bat on his head. So then what did she do? Did she put him in a closet? Was that what happened? Or
well, at that particular time, she figures he's down. Mm-hmm. She doesn't stop there, though.
No, but wait, there's more?
There's more. She takes a plastic bag, kind of a, she believes, is a coup de grace, and she wraps it around his head and ties it off as though if he wasn't, he would suffocate.
Jesus.
And I found that she had talked about this to one of her other girls up at the ranch. She had talked about, this is what I'm going to do, and asked her, in fact, why don't you come and help me? We'll put up some kind of a thing where we could overtake him or do. And the other girl's looking at her like, get out of here. You know, but she had mentioned, you know, hey, why don't we do this? You talk to him and then I'll come up behind him and put a plastic bag over his head and we'll suffocate him. You know, and then when I read that and then I could see the crime scene, you know, what had happened there, there was no, she had that in mind, that if her stabbing and the baseball bat wasn't enough, then the plastic bag might do the trick and suffocate him. And so that's the way we found him. And she had actually dragged him from the family room all the way back to the bedroom and had placed him in the closet. And that's where he was found by his son.
So it must have been blood everywhere. I mean, it must have been just a mess.
You know, there was a big spot of blood in the family room, in the carpet. Mm-hmm. But unless you stood back and just kind of looked around slowly, you could see where the spray was all over the walls,
okay,
on the ceiling. But just walking in the mobile home like I did, mm-hmm, you couldn't see anything. You could see the spot, but you had to quickly start looking around. I mean, this type of blood spatter, mm-hmm, he was being hit so hard that basically the blood in most cases will just turn into a mist.
Oh, okay.
And the mist and the little tiny droplets will connect it to the walls and stuff like that. But I had found out that Michelle had actually cleaned up as much as she could.
Because she spent the night there, right?
She didn't do that. She stayed and had some food. She ate some dinner.
Oh, she ate dinner?
Oh, yeah.
After?
She wanted to eat dinner she left.
She was swinging a bat.
Yeah. She cleaned up and she got her clothes cleaned up. And then after everything was done, she went out, loaded up the Mercedes and drove off.
And she got her Mercedes.
She got her Mercedes and she took off at that time. But yeah, there was, you couldn't tell right away. But after you looked around, I found blood. I mean, in the bathroom was just a lot of blood. It looked like it was trying to, you know, someone had tried to clean it up. But I mean, it was just horrific.
Yeah,
the scene was horrific.
She probably gave up on that real quick.
Right. Yeah. But the initial, when you walk in the door, you couldn't tell anything had ever happened until you went into the family room. Uh-huh. And then, of course, into the bedroom. And then, you know, you could see that there was blood everywhere. Everywhere I was looking, doorknobs, everywhere in the house that I would take and particularly look at, you know, really deeply, I could see that there was blood spots or something that she had touched. But there was blood. There was blood everywhere. You just had to find it.
My God. And then he was discovered by the son, right?
He was discovered by his son.
Day.
Yeah, it was very sad. Very sad. He hadn't shown up for work. Mm-hmm. And so his boss was kind of concerned. And eventually on March 7th, you know, a couple of days later, his son went over, saw that his car was gone and thought, wow, his car's gone. Okay, maybe he'd gone somewhere. And then he went up and tried the door of the home and it was open. And he went inside, lights are off. And he walks around, gets the lights on. He looks around. You know, he can't really tell anything has really happened. He sees a blood spot and that concerns him on the carpet. He starts searching around more and then he looks into the closet and he finds his father in there and he calls 911. Yeah. Very, very, very tragic. Very tragic.
And were you one of the, no, you're not the first on the scene. They call you.
No, I wasn't. Right. Yeah. I got a call. It was about 8 o'clock, a little after eight, you know, that night. I remember the night exactly. I mean, it was, here we are. It was March 7th. Around 8 o'clock at night, it was really cold outside. You know, that Sacramento cold, mm-hmm, plus being out there in the
out
wilderness.
Out there, yeah.
Oh, it was even double cold.
Right, it was.
And dark. And, you know, the stars were out, but it was cold as everything. And I remember, and I thought, wow, you know.
Yeah.
And so I got out there, and yeah, I was a lead detective, took over the case, and started doing the investigation.
So, yeah, I can't emphasize this enough that the setting of this crime was really a big part of it too, because again, in 1991, that little trailer park was all by itself in the middle of these big old fields. It was not what you think of today when you think of Natomas. It was a very dark, foggy place because it's hard by the river. So you get that, you know, that fog in the mornings. It gets very cold there. And it was very, that's my memory of Natomas in that era. Dark. It was just always dark.
Well, the thing that I remember is that when I got out of my car at the mobile home park, it was dead silence. You might hear a barking dog off into the distance, but I mean, you could hear everything. You could hear the cars over on I-5. Mm. There was no sound. I mean, it was just clear and dead out there. And because that was the only thing out there.
Mm-hmm.
But, it was just a really eerie night. Mm-hmm. Very calm, very quiet.
Now, let's come to the part where you shine. So, tracking this down, like how quickly were you able to put the spotlight on Batgirl? And when did she get that nickname, by the way? How did that happen?
It started out as a whodunit. We didn't have any idea who would have committed this crime. No forced entry. Mm-hmm. It didn't appear anything was ransacked, so there wasn't any kind of a robbery or a burglary or something like that. So we knew right away it had to be somebody that he let in or somebody he knew. So that starts, you know, narrowing the investigation. However, we still didn't have any clues. Based on what we were told by the family, they didn't know anyone other than the people that he saw. So we started gathering names. But where it starts for me is on the bedstand next to the bed, there's a small piece of paper. And on that piece of paper is a name, Jade Cabading, and a phone number, an address in Citrus Heights. So I thought to myself, that's pretty significant, because who keeps a piece of paper unless you know someone or you're contacting someone? Why would you keep that on the bedstand next to the phone? So that would be where I began my start. But of course, in the initial investigation, nobody knew who Jade was. Nobody knew that name. So it took weeks to finally get going, start putting out information. In doing so, and trying to learn who the individual was that might have been there or who he was involved with, slowly but surely, we started getting information. Information started coming in. Some of it was coming in from the news that had been out there that this individual had been killed and his car was stolen. And fortunately, some of the girls that knew Michelle.
Oh, they're spilling the beans.
They started saying, you know what? I knew somebody that had talked to something similar. And we started slowly getting information. And of course, that started leading us to more and more. And we subsequently, after about 2 or 3 weeks, we believe we identified her. Jade Cabading was actually, in fact, Michelle Cummiskey. And, you know, what was really fortunate at the time, and I'm so grateful for, is that we had to make phone calls to Reno PD. Now, remember, everything we did was by telephone teletype.
That's right.
Or you send a letter.
Right.
I mean, there wasn't none of this instantaneous, you can find this stuff out right away.
Right.
And we relied heavily on our homicide buddies and other agencies.
There was no Ring camera where you saw Jade leaving the mobile home, right?
No.
It's like, no.
Nothing. Yeah. And with the help of detectives from Reno PD, great detectives, Dave Jenkins, you know, Steve Pitts and Jim Duncan, those guys were so much help because they knew a lot about Mustang Ranch, about the girls and stuff. And plus, they would help us get into a lot of that. They'd open up a lot of doors for me in getting her identified. Because, of course, we were law enforcement officers in the state of California. We had no jurisdiction in the state of Nevada. And so they opened up a lot of doors for us. And after identifying her, I remember the Sacramento Bee wanted to do a story on the murder.
Yeah, because she was loose, right? This is a big deal.
Right. She was out there. Somebody was out there. Now we identified her. Somebody was out there. And I had already had gotten a hold of photographs that her girlfriends gave us. I mean, people were giving us all these photographs and said, I don't want them. Take them. So they gave us these photographs.
Yeah.
And they had the ones with the bats in the arm. And they explained, oh, she loved bats. And then the vampire bite marks and all of that. And I was like, wow. You know, unbelievable. But one evening, we were in the office doing follow-up work on this. Of course, we were trying to find out where is she? Where did she go? And I knew that what I had to rely on was the media. At that time, the media was so much, you know, working with you, and you really needed the media to get the information out. I mean, that was it. It was, you couldn't go to social media.
Right.
You know, you didn't have anything like that. You had newspapers, and then you had local radio and television stations. So I talked to a reporter. She was a crime reporter by the name of Diana Sugg. And we were just talking, and she said, you know, give me a little information about this gal, you know. So all right, we get a story going. And I remember the bats, and I just said, I'm calling her the Batgirl. And right away, I saw Diana's ears perk up and said, what?
That's a winner.
And I said, the bad girl. And she goes, why do you call her the bad girl? And I could see, ooh, okay. And I said, well, she had all these bats. She had these, you know, bite marks. And she was into Satanism and all of this stuff. And wow, that did it. It was like, oh my goodness. And so Diana Sugg wrote a story. And the story she wrote hit AP, and I mean, it went across like wildfire.
It was a huge
across
deal.
The nation.
Oh yeah, it was a huge deal. I was here, and I was like, "Oh my God, the Batgirl! Like she's on the loose.
She's on
Where
the
is
loose.
She? Am you I know? Next?"
And so yeah, it was. And so I was so grateful, and years after that, I always told my detective colleagues, especially the new ones coming in, you know, learn to work with the media because they're going to help you. Mm-hmm. You know, work with them. You know, and they're going to do some good things for you.
So Jade, Batgirl, Michelle, I mean, she was smart in that she didn't go back to her apartment because you would have got her right there, right?
Oh, yeah.
You would have pulled her out of bed. So she had a plan.
Oh, yeah.
This girl, she is smart. So she took the car. She didn't go back home. She didn't go to Reno.
No.
She headed east, right?
Well, she went south, first of all.
Oh, south. Okay. Yeah.
She goes down to Southern California, and she ends up and goes to Los Angeles and gets with a group of people. Here again, she meets with another group of people. They end up going to Las Vegas, and she's with this entourage that's in the heavyweight boxing match, Tyson and Ruddick.
My God.
So she's with this entourage of people that are with one of these boxers, and they're all in Las Vegas partying.
At the Tyson Razor Ruddick fight?
Yes. In Las Vegas. And the reason I know that is because one of the gentlemen that was with her, and they were all out, he's watching TV one evening, and he sees this show at the time was called Hard Copy.
Uh-huh.
And they have this story about Batgirl. You know, where is she? Hey, look at what's happening. And he just realizes, oh my gosh, I was with her tonight. And so he makes a couple of phone calls to LAPD people that he knew, some detectives. And they said, you sure? Go back and find. He goes, yeah, she's been staying at this hotel over here and, you know, all this stuff. So they tell, hey, go back and see if she's still there. Let us know. And he finds that she's gone. Because apparently she probably saw Hard Copy too. Mm-hmm. But he has a phone call with her. And he's talking to her, and he says, hey, look, are you the one that was on TV? And she said, yeah, you know, yeah, but, and he goes, did you really kill that guy? You know, things like that. And she was like, no, that none of that ever happened. That's not the way it happened. But she didn't say other than he was just like shocked.
Yeah.
You know, and then basically the phone call ended, and that was the last he heard. But he had volunteered that. He called and volunteered that information up on what he had. So, you know, the media shows were following her. So whenever something like that would arise, she would take off. So from there, we find that she heads to Phoenix. And she's in Phoenix for a while because what happens is they see something in the media. And she decides before that, she's quitting and she's dancing in a strip club. And her and another gal are heading to Florida, which is her plan all the time. She wants to get to Miami. And I believe she wants to get to Miami because then she wants to get over to the Caribbean. And I think in her mind, she thinks once she gets over there, there's no way anybody's going to ever find her. And I'll tell you, with the connection she made, we might have never found her. You know, because you're over on an island where there are all kinds of nefarious people and they're not going to give you squat. And that was her plan. And I always remember that girl up in Mustang saying, You know, she said she was going to always get to Miami. And I kept thinking, she's heading to Miami. You know, so I would put bulletins out, possibly heading to Florida, you know. So.
But didn't she have the bats tattooed? Wasn't that easily identifiable?
It was, but in Phoenix, she goes to another tattoo artist and has it covered. Oh. And she puts kind of a band on it. It's really, it's kind of a plain band, but it covers the bats.
Okay.
And, but actually, in my opinion, it looked worse.
Okay.
Yes. And so she has this different colored band on, so you don't see the bats anymore. But she doesn't do anything because her hair is covering
the bites. The
vampire bite marks on her neck. And the blood drips. There's drips of blood coming from them. But you can't see them. But she does that in Phoenix, and then she decides she's leaving, and they take off. So she leaves Phoenix. The business owner we end up contacting, he tells us everything. Yeah, she worked here for a while, you know, did this and did that, and then she disappeared. He saw what had happened. He thought, oh, my gosh, she was working here. And so now we know she's on the run again. Every time something would pop up, boom. Because I had asked her, how are you always thinking? She goes, I always see something on the news. And I thought, I had to go. I had to go.
Good for her. She admitted it.
So she's driving with her and her girlfriend. They rent a U-Haul. Phil Inhofer's Mercedes was red.
Right.
However, while she's there in Phoenix for a short time, she has it painted silver.
Oh.
And she painted it silver because Satan told her to paint it silver. That's what she told me. Satan told her to paint it silver because it would be a good conductor between him and her. So I couldn't figure that out. I'm not an electrician or anything, but I couldn't figure that out.
Or a Satanist.
Or a Satanist, so I can't figure that out. Yeah. But that's what she said. Okay. So she painted it. And obviously to me, the reason she painted it was to, it wasn't going to be red anymore.
Yeah.
However, she puts it in the back of the U-Haul truck, and here they go. And they're heading down the highway, and they're coming right into Biloxi, Mississippi.
On the way to Florida.
On the way to Florida. Not a problem. She pulls over in the daytime, and her and her girlfriend, her friend that is traveling with her, they're going to eat some crackers and kind of get some food. But in the meantime, what they don't know is that the door on the U-Haul has slipped up.
Oh.
And they stopped on the roadway in a parking area, but sitting across the other side of the road is a police officer. And he's looking at this truck, and he sees that the door is open, and there is a car in the back. So, curiosity killed the cat. He decides, you know, I'm just going to check and see what this is all about, you know. And so he drives over there, gets out, sees that the vehicle's in the back. No license plate. Of course, we've already entered the information on the victim's car into the system. He goes over and addresses the person who's driving the vehicle, who he identifies later as Michelle. And he says, do you have a driver's license? And she tells him, no, I don't. I don't have any my driver's license. So the other gal says, I have one, and ponies up the driver's license. So he says, you know, the reason I'm talking to you is because your door is up and there's a car back there. And, you know, it'll either fall out or something to that nature. But anyway, he says, you mind stepping out of the vehicle? They step out of the vehicle, go to the back, you know, and she says she's basically transporting the car. They're heading to Miami. She's transporting the car. And he realizes there's no plate. So he says, do you mind if I check the vehicle? And, you know, and she says, no, go ahead. So he gets up in there, no plate, but he runs a VIN number, which, of course, she has no idea has a VIN number. He runs a VIN number, and immediately it comes back. The vehicle belongs to a homicide victim. He gets back out, takes her into custody, and takes her other girlfriend into custody. So now they're both in custody. And they get the, you know, the wanted bulletin information. And now the word, all of a sudden, like wildfire, Batgirl's been apprehended in Biloxi, Mississippi. Yeah.
Was this the girl that she was with in the U-Haul? Was that the same one that stole?
No. This is another girl that she had met in Phoenix at the club.
Okay.
And they decided they'd go to Miami together. Because she had told her, hey, I've got a lot of friends in Miami, stuff like that.
God damn.
So they were on their way. They were on their way, and they just made that fatal move of pulling over in Biloxi, and there was a police officer you know, that I look at as saying, hey, the guy was doing his job.
Yeah.
He sees a U-Haul with a car with no license plate stuck in the back, you know. Hey, I'd probably do this. I'd want to find out, you know, what's happening. If anything, your door's up.
What are the odds? She was that close to getting away.
I truly believe if she would have made it to Miami, she'd have either left the car there or loaded it up, and she would have gotten to the Bahamas.
Yeah.
And that would have been a really difficult situation.
It is always a stupid mistake. Always, or someone just happened to be there, like the cop. Just happened to be there.
He just happened to be sitting across there, you know, watching traffic, and sees a U-Haul parked there. Mm-hmm.
So you fly down, right? I don't know. Did you take a train? Was it that long ago?
Yeah.
You fly down.
Well, the Wright brothers weren't available, so you know, I had to get other transportation. But after finding out that she was in custody, the first thing, of course, is I got to get there.
Yeah,
we got to immediately. See if we can talk to her. That's key. And so I get on a plane. I fly out there. I see that she has not waived extradition, which means that she's got to have a court hearing, which means that they've got to put on a hearing to see if she can be extradited back to California on our warrant. I get down there. I meet with the detective, and who was great. Again, you know, I have no jurisdiction in Mississippi. And he opens all the doors. He does everything. I mean, it's a courtesy. It's just what we do as homicide investigators. And he starts doing, like, getting all the paperwork ready for me. Eventually, I get to go out where she's located. She's in Gulfport, Mississippi. She's in the jail out there being held. And so the next day after I arrived, I get everything together and all the notes and everything I want to talk about. And I'm going to go out there, and I notify that I'm coming out to talk to her. And so that's where I go. I go out there. I take my recording device because I want to record everything. And I get out there. I set it up. And for the first time, she walks in and I'm sitting face to face with the Batgirl.
What's your first impression of her when she came in?
Kind of cocky. Huh. She was looking at me a little cocky, like, you know, hey, who are you? Or, you know, what's going on? Kind of like, you know, it's like no care in the world. Wow. And she sat down, I introduced myself, and immediately I told her, I said, I'm a homicide detective, you know, I'm from Sacramento. And, you know, I said, I'm here investigating this murder, you know, and then I Mirandized her. You have to Mirandize her, give her rights. Mm-hmm. I give her all the opportunity in the world to tell me to go pound sand. She doesn't, waives the rights, so now I can talk to her. I made sure I had witnesses, you know, I have somebody there that witnesses it. And plus we have a recording. And so, you know, one of the first things I asked her is if she killed, you know, Phil Enhofer. And the first thing I asked her, I said, are you Michelle Cummiskey? And I thought, okay, real basic question. And she went, you know, I don't know who I am. And right away I thought, oh boy, here we go. And then, you know, of course I asked her about the name Jade Cabining, and eventually she, yeah, you know, I am those people. And then we get into Phil. And one of the first things I wanted to ask her right off the bat was, did you kill Phil Enhofer? You know, and, you know, she was crying. She didn't want to, she was starting to get a little emotional. And she wouldn't say, she wouldn't tell me she killed Phil Enhofer. What she would tell me is that she hurt Phil.
Okay.
But that she loved him. And she hurt him.
Okay.
And then she went on with this whole story about what happened. And so I just listened, you know, and I had a few questions, but I wanted her to tell me her side of what happened. And so she did.
And that was that Satan made her do it?
She said that they were there at the mobile home. He went into the shower. She went back into the other room. She dropped some LSD. And when she walked into the bathroom, she looked at Phil and there were all these snakes coming out of his neck. And she had told me also that Satan had told her she needed a sacrifice, and to sacrifice basically Phil. And she goes in there and she says, I see this monster and I have to do this. And then she keeps just saying that she hurt him. She would never tell me she stabbed him, that she hurt him.
Do you believe it? Do you believe the whole, that her story?
No.
She probably took LSD, right? I mean, she could have.
She could have, but, yeah. You know, you take drugs like that. The way she killed him, boy, I'll tell you, it took a lot of thought.
Yeah, I think, you know what?
It took a lot of energy. And you're right. It took a lot of thought. If you're on LSD, you're out there in la-la mm-hmm. land.
Yeah, you're right.
You know?
The way she did it was very methodical.
Right.
Yeah.
But it was a good way to, you know, to segue into I was under drugs, I was mm-hmm. under the influence, you know, that kind of a deal.
Yeah.
But he gets in the shower. While he's showering, she goes in. She starts stabbing him methodically. Mm-hmm. I mean, she's pouring this knife into him.
She has the wherewithal to break a knife and get an additional yes. knife, right? Yes. That's not LSD.
No, one is not enough.
Yeah.
Yeah. She goes and gets another one because the pathologist finds that there's two different types of wounds. Mm-hmm. So we know there's two knives.
Right.
And plus one of them's embedded in him. But then he gets out and he's probably, you know, grabbing for her or the knife to stop. Mm-hmm. But she's just flailing away at him. And that's when they get back into the family room. And eventually he's bleeding and he goes down.
And that's when she gets the bat.
That's when she goes
Which is down. Ironic since her name is Batgirl.
That's right. And we would find the bat also. The aluminum bat I did find.
Oh, where was that?
When I flew back to Biloxi, I had also had a search warrant. And I had a search warrant for the vehicle and her possessions. And so going through the truck on the back seat.
Oh,
yeah, going through the truck, I found that aluminum baseball bat and I looked at it and I could see what appeared to be blood smear.
Oh my God.
And so that bat became a piece of evidence. And then I searched a lot of her personal things. And that's when I found a lot of ledgers. I found cards, names. I mean, it was endless. It was endless. I also found a gun. She carried a gun. Her girlfriend stole me. She had a gun. She had a semi-automatic handgun.
And she was 19.
19.
So, what I found interesting with this case is that she disappeared after that. I remember that she was caught. I remember she was apprehended. And then it kind of like, then she was sentenced and it was all gone. There wasn't a long drawn out trial and the whole case wasn't rehashed in the public and her story, you know what I mean? It was like, Batgirl's on the loose. This guy's been brutally murdered. She's been caught. And then it kind of faded away.
Television shows, media, everybody. I mean, she was the focus mm-hmm. at that time. This was a big thing. You know, where's the Batgirl? The kind of crime. Oh my gosh, horrific crime.
Yeah.
And her age. I think that's what stunned a lot of people.
And her looks were part of it.
Yeah, and her looks. I mean, she's known as the American vamp.
Yeah.
You know, and she became a focal point. But what had happened is because we had a grand jury indictment mm-hmm. and that cut down on having a preliminary hearing so the public wouldn't be invited.
Right.
And then, of course, it would be a year before we finally went back into court. But during that time, her attorney had sought and received a gag order.
Oh, okay.
So the attorneys couldn't talk about the case. You can't talk about much. So nothing was going out. Nothing was coming in. So everything was very limited. And then, of course, after 1 year, a plea deal was struck. No death penalty case. It would be a 27 to life sentence. Mm-hmm.
So she struck a plea deal.
Right.
There's never a trial.
No.
Yeah. So that's, I guess that explains.
The public is cut out.
Yeah.
The public is cut out. All that information, in which a lot of it I've talked about today, all of that would never be heard by the public because I think it would have curled their socks. They couldn't wrap their head around a person this young being on the road since 14, mm-hmm. you know, and getting better at what she was doing to a point where she decided, this is what I want. She wanted a car mm-hmm. and she was going to get it. No matter which way she had to get it.
Is that why you find her one of the most fascinating and why you always say, David, you got to do this case. We have to talk about this case. Is that one of the things that you find most fascinating about this case? Because you did kind of say that in the media, too.
Right.
Because plot twist, she's back in the public now. She's been released.
Yes.
She is on parole. She's on parole. She's on parole. She could be living next to you. Who knows where she is?
Right.
Who knows what she looks like? Because I have seen no pictures of her since the pictures that were in the press, you know, in 1991.
Right.
Big plot twist. She is in the public now. The woman that stabbed him 30 something times, that beat him in the head with an aluminum bat so loud that people across the way heard it, had a gun, right? She was very thoughtful, methodical.
Right.
She's back in the society now.
She is out there.
Yeah.
She's back into society. She did almost 30 years.
So she's still
life.
Relatively young.
Yeah, she's probably just under 50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's still out there.
Yeah, she is.
Have you seen any pictures of her?
Nothing. No. Once, you know, she's paroled, that information, you know, it's not open to the public where she goes, not unless there is a safety issue, you know, like in some cases. But in her case, I think, you know, she could have been paroled back to Iowa.
She could have been paroled
That's
back
possible.
To Citrus
that,
Heights.
She could be just paroled here in California.
Yeah.
But we don't know. We have no idea.
We have no idea where she is. No. But she is. She's out there right now.
Yeah.
She could be listening to this possibly. At some point when it comes up.
Possibly.
Because I'm sure she does Google searches on herself all the time.
A lot has changed since she was out.
Yes,
there.
A lot. You know what? For a person like her, her game could get a lot more refined. I mean, if she still has that. I don't know if these people age out, but she did make a lot of money.
Yeah. I would hope that, you know, and I'm saying that what she was doing in going into a women's prison, I mean, what kind of trade do you learn? But I would hope that she was able to look deeply back into herself, into her life, and to see that maybe she had committed a wrong and whatever the issues were that drove her there, that she had somehow overcome them. That would be my hope, and that she's out living a productive life and that nobody else has any safety issues with her.
I mean, I hope so. And I think like with Carla Homolka, you know, up in Canada, you know, we've seen that I guess she's back out, but she has cameras on her 24/7. It's hard for her, really. But I'm just trying to talk through a little bit here. But if I'm Jade, Batgirl, Michelle, and I really know no other life since I was 14. I mean, all I've known since I was 14 was grifting, right? And then I graduated to murder at 19. All of her formative years were based around grifting and getting over.
Using men. Yeah. You know, a couple of the girls had said that, you know, she used them because she could have hated them. I don't know. Something, there could have been something there, you know, that
That's
she used
true.
Men because she could get away with it. And she liked to use military men. Also, she's here for a while. She takes off and heads to Hawaii, one of the other places that you had mentioned. Yeah, mm-hmm. The Army base. She gets into a strip club. She's dancing there and meets a young Army soldier. Subsequently ends up marrying him. However, during their marriage, which was brief, he starts becoming ill and getting sick. Very sick, to the point where his commanding officer is saying, hey, what's wrong with you? Something's wrong with you. And so they put this report together, the CID. They develop a report about the possibility of his wife poisoning him. And then there's questions about, you know, do you know your wife's real name? Is she still married? Because she had told the soldier that she had been married. They're asking, do you even know anything about her? Well, anyway, that's a report they had made, the CID. They were so concerned. So he tells her, no, I'm just getting sick. No, she wouldn't be poisoning me. However, we had a witness statement who said she was there at the time that Michelle was putting decon into some food that she was making for her husband.
Oh, my God. We have both of the patterns here.
Yeah. Now, anyway, it all kind of catches up. The Army now goes out looking for her, right? CID. She flees now. Flees Hawaii and heads back to her home. She's at her home briefly, and then she ends up at Mustang Ranch in Reno.
Oh, my God. And then here comes Phil.
And then after a short time of getting stabilized there, she meets her other girlfriends, and now she spreads her tentacles again out to the Sacramento area, out to Citrus Heights where she's living. And from there, she just continues on because she's becoming successful at it. And she prides herself about how men just fall all over her.
I had no idea about the marriages and the patterns, the behavior patterns that she, you know, showed during both of those. But how does she change? She's back in our community. She's at a relatively young age. I don't know how she has aged, right? Physically, which was her main weapon,
right?
If we're honest,
right?
But how does she change that? That's the only way she has known to be successful in our world, and now she could be someone's neighbor. Like, can she really be rehabilitated, Michelle Cummiskey?
You know, I don't know. Again, I would hope so. I would hope that losing 30 years of her life as a young person, when people, you know, you grow up after high school, you, all the things that you do, you know, the fun that you have. She sat in a women's correctional facility for almost 30 years. I would hope that that would change her to where she would become something, you know, else other than her past when she's out now. But you just don't know. And we may never know unless something comes out. Maybe someday we'll read about it again. But unless she does something. But yeah, we don't know.
So, you know, to close up, is this, so what about this did you find the most fascinating as you delved into the world of Michelle Cummiskey? And believe me, this is incredibly fascinating. And I'm glad we're doing this episode, because more people should know this story. Because again, like I said, in Sacramento, it was a big deal.
Yes.
And they had the apprehension, and it just faded away. But there's so much more here.
Right.
So much deeper. With the ultimate plot twist is that she's now released and back in our community.
Right.
What do you, you know, your final points, what do you find most fascinating about this?
I found most remarkable is the number of men that would simply just fall prey to her. You know, not in being a victim, but just they had to be around her. They had to be with her. And they went through great lengths. And I mean, it wasn't just 10 or 20. I mean, I'm talking lots of men. And, you know, and she told me that she liked being around military bases because she felt military men were easy prey. And so she liked being around military bases. But no matter where she went, she was always in the middle of the circle. You know, and it was just fascinating. And I think the fact that she starts out at 14 and at 19, she reaches a point where she wants something so bad, she plans and kills this Mr. Phil Inhofer. I mean, it isn't spontaneous. She kills him. She's telling her girlfriends, I'll get it one way or the other. On the way down, she stops to get rat poison. I mean, no matter, it was going to happen, you know, and, it's just fascinating that she would continue this until she got caught, thinking, you know, if she wasn't going to get caught. But she actually thought she was going to get to Miami. She actually thought that. And, you know, I've never had a case like that.
Yeah.
With so many people involved. And I made lots of phone calls. And I know there was a lot of people that were nervous at the other end. But, of course, we don't care about that.
I bet there are a lot of those people that you talked to, even after they heard what she did, they probably still would have taken her back.
Well, I have to tell you this. Her husband, the one in Hawaii.
Who she tried to kill.
That she tried to poison, kill, you know. Because basically out of that marriage, she wanted when they got married, she had him up his insurance. His life insurance at $30,000. And that she wanted the $30,000. But even after all of that, even in the report, he still said, no, she loves me. She would never do this. And he tried to, in a letter, he tried to get back with her. After all of this, he still loved her, still wanted her. And, you know, it was incredible. Now, some of the photographs she gave to her men friends, they brought them into me. They would say, here's a photograph she gave me. And, you know, it's something like,
you brought a lot of
to here. To yeah. my love or, you yeah. know, and they kept on and they just said, I don't want anything to do with this person.
Yeah, she was good.
And you know,
for those who are watching,
she had her photos. She yeah. just, oh yeah. And they, I think what it was is that she made each person, each man, she made them feel special. I mean, here's this good looking girl, young, vivacious, full of energy, you know, like to do things. And they just thought, wow, this person is great. And she likes me.
No, she should have went into politics.
Good point.
She should have.
Right. You know,
she would have succeeded.
People love me, you know,
yes.
And, but she had that kind of personality that it was just overwhelming and men would just be drawn to it. I mean, it was just like a magnet. It was incredible. Incredible story. Incredible investigation.
Yeah.
I'm grateful that I was able to cap it and get her to admit to it and put it behind us because I know it was painful for the family.
Well, hopefully this is the end of the Michelle Cummiskey story and not just chapter one. But she has been paroled. She's back in our community. And let's see. Let's see how it plays out. Detective Cabrera, thank you so much. It's always awesome. I already have some other ones I want to talk to you about. But this was, I know now why you were always telling me we got to do Michelle Cummiskey.
Yeah, it's amazing.
She's just so fascinating.
Amazing story.
Yeah.
Amazing story.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
All right.